I finally think, after sort of 50 years of thinking about it, that I finally nailed down how it really works and how it sort of arises from this kind of interplay between computational irreducibility and our nature as observers. And I was like, let me really check that I'm actually getting it right. And, you know, I'd known about the second law for a very long time. And the second law is one of these things which in a textbook, you'll often see the textbook say, oh, you can derive that entropy increases. You say, well, actually, you can flip around this argument and say that the same argument will say that entropy should decrease. And the, you know, my favorite is the books where the chapter ends, this point is often puzzling to the student. It's been puzzling to everybody else too. But, you know, the question was, why did people come up with the things they came up with in this area? And so I went and kind of untangled the whole history of the second law, which I was surprised nobody had written before. Although after I figured it out, I wasn't as surprised, because it's really complicated. And it requires kind of understanding various points of view that people had that are a little bit tricky to understand. But I think, you know, in the end, I feel very confident that, you know, how what I've figured out fits into what people have known before, what people have sort of been able to do experiments on, and so on. And that's a, you know, that for me is an important sort of step in the kind of the philosophy, the computational experiments, the homework, so to speak. I mean, I find that, you know, if I study some field and I'm like trying to read all these papers and so on, and it's a complicated field with lots of complicated formalism, I find it difficult to absorb all that stuff. For me, it's actually easier just to work it out for myself. And then see where those chips have fallen, and then go back and figure out what the history is, and see how what I've done relates to that history. Maybe sometimes, it's not so common, I have to say, but sometimes I'll discover something in the history where I say, that's an interesting idea, and I can use that idea in something that I'm trying to do. It tends to be the case that I've kind of learnt enough of the ambient kind of history beforehand that I'm not usually surprised at that level. But it's always a humbling experience to learn some new field, because you always, a field I've been trying to learn for a while is economics, which is deeply related to kind of structure of human society and so on. And I'm still at the stage, it's as happens whenever I learn a field, that for a while, every new person I talk to will tell me something I didn't know that makes me very confused about what is actually going on in the field. I feel like I'm just at the crest of the hill now for economics. It's starting to be the case that I've heard that idea before, and I'm beginning to understand how it fits into the sort of global set of things that I'm thinking about. And I do think, by the way, that it's going to turn out that economics, like biology, well, economics thinks it has more theories than biology thinks it has. There's sort of a question of what kind of a thing is economics? What are its foundational questions? What can one actually understand? I'm not there yet, but I think it is really clear to me that the methodologies that I've developed are going to be very relevant to that. I don't know how it will come out. That's one of these things you have to let the chips fall as they will. You know, I don't know how it's going to come out. I don't know whether, I mean, I have kind of prejudices about what I'm going to learn about, you know, cryptocurrencies and things like this, which is an interesting case because it's kind of a case where sort of all there is the kind of economic network. There isn't the kind of obvious underlying human utility of things. I mean, just to give a preview of some of the thinking there, one of the questions in economics is, what is value? What makes something valuable? And my proto-theory of that, which is subject to change because not fully worked out at all, is in the end, the main thing that's valuable is essentially computational reducibility. In other words, in the world at large, there's lots of computational irreducibility, lots of things that are unpredictable, lots of things you can't do quickly and so on. But we humans have one thing in fairly short supply, and that's time, because at least for the time being, we're mortal. We have only a limited amount of time. So for us, anything that kind of speeds up what we can achieve is something that is valuable to us. And computational reducibility is the possibility of finding these little pockets where you can kind of jump ahead, where you're not stuck just going through letting things work as they work, so to speak.
I see.
So I think the, you know, my proto-theory is that the ultimate concept of the ultimate source of value is pockets of computational reusability. The fact that you can sort of put together a smartphone and it's a whole smartphone rather than having to, you know, get all the ingredients together and just go step by step, so to speak. If we had infinite time, we could build every smartphone from scratch ourselves. But because we only have finite lifetimes, it's worthwhile for us to, you know, to have the finished goods, so to speak. It's the very beginning. I'm just trying to understand these things.
But roughly speaking, anything that saves us time will be valuable, or at least what is valuable will save us time. And then what saves us time is something that's computationally reducible.
Yes, that's the idea. And I mean, I think there's sort of questions about kind of what, you know, when you invent something, how do you build on that invention? How do you take that lump of reducibility and make use of it and so on? What is the value of that invention? That's not something usually taken into account in economics. You know, there's the scarcity of stuff, but not the value of this idea and so on. And in biology, we can see the same thing happening. There is some sort of piece of reducibility, some mechanism that you see being found, and then that mechanism is reused. I don't understand how this stuff works yet, but this is, you know, in the end, it's kind of a theory that allows one to understand something about kind of about the function of things, as well as about the mechanism by which the things occur, so to speak. But, you know, this is, so for me, I mean, in terms of doing a project like that, it's sort of this mixture of sort of the philosophy of what's going on, the kind of conceptual framework, a bunch of computer experiments to see what actually happens, and then sort of a doing one's homework understanding of how this fits into what other people have figured out. And it's you know, a thing that I've done for the last 30 years or so now is, you know, in academia, it's often like you write a paper and then you're like, get some citations, you know, let's boom, boom, boom. This is whatever. I have to say, I find it amusing that people have pointed out to me that citations to my own stuff sort of got corrupted in various databases. And so people are now copying the utterly incorrect citations that are just complete nonsense. And you can kind of see that they didn't look at anything. They just like click, click, click. You know, now I've papered my paper, so to speak, by putting in the right citations. The other thing that's amusing to me right now is because papers aren't on paper anymore, it's starting to be the case that you can have the, you know, citations where they'll cite all 1,000 authors explicitly. It's very nice and egalitarian. And it means that the length of the, you know, I'm always, when I'm reading papers, I'm always like, something exciting is about to happen. Something exciting is about to happen. Oh, shit, we reached the end of the paper. Nothing happened.
Right.
Now, and I thought I hadn't reached the end because the thumb on my, you know, as I'm moving down on the on
you
my
can
window.
See the percentage.
Yeah, right. It's like there's still a lot of way to go, but no, actually it's just pages and pages and pages of citations. But, you know, what I've always thought, at least for the last 30 years, the much more interesting thing is the actual narrative history of the ideas.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.